Let's start with the views side of the layout negotiation and look at how a view tells a panel its preferred size and position. Views tend to size themselves just large enough to fit around their content. For example, label and button both typically size themselves just large enough to show their text. In this case, the label shown here fits snugly around the text hello. There are a lot of other factors that influence the final size, both settings on the view and the layout algorithm. We'll see all the details shortly. There are four properties that influence a view's rendered size. They're all requests and may be overridden by the layout container. The first two are for sizing. You can set a width and a height value on the view. Notice that word request in the property names. These views use these properties to tell the layout panel its preference, but the layout makes the final sizing decision. The other two properties give positioning information. Vertical options and horizontal options influence how the view is positioned within its rectangle allocated by the layout container. You can specify you want to be aligned to one of the four edges of the rectangle, or that you want to occupy the entire rectangle. Notice when we set width request and height request, we use literal values like 100. At the Xamarin Forms level, these values have no units. They're not points or pixels. They're just values of type double. Xamarin Forms passes these values on to the underlying operating system. It's the operating system that provides the context needed to decide what these numbers mean. On Windows, these values are interpreted as effective pixels. On iOS, the values are called points. And on Android, they're density-independent pixels. Now let's look at how this translation from literal values to concrete units plays out. Your Xamarin Forms app will likely run on multiple operating systems and on a wide range of devices. The width request and height request values you set in your Xamarin Forms code are interpreted at runtime according to the rules of the operating system based on the screen size and resolution. The typical behavior for each OS is to apply a scale factor to your values to determine the number of physical pixels for a view. For example, if this app were run on the Windows device shown, the 100 by 300 label would render as 200 by 600 pixels, since the device uses a scale factor of 2. On an iPhone 6s, we would again see 200 by 600 physical pixels, since it also has a scale factor of 2. The screen of a Nexus 6 has a higher pixel density, so the scale factor is 3.5, resulting in a rendered size of 350 by 1050 pixels. Since values like width request and height request properties might not be respected at runtime, they cannot be used to see the result of your layout algorithm. For example, if you set width request to 100, its value will still be 100 after the layout algorithm runs, regardless of whether the view is actually given 100 units by the layout panel. Instead, several other read-only properties tell you the actual size of a view in platform-independent units. X and Y give you the distances from the upper left corner of the layout. Width and height tell you the size. And bounds is a convenience property that returns a rectangle containing all four values, X, Y, width, and height. These properties are updated every time the layout algorithm runs. Remember that the layout container gives each child view a rectangle. This rectangle is the area where the child will be rendered. The view's horizontal options and vertical options control the placement of the child within this rectangle. It's actually a bit trickier than that simple statement. The layout options struct has two properties, one used by all layouts and one which is only used for stack layout. Let's look at the details next. The layout options struct's two properties are both related to layout, but they're not related to each other. Layout options is fairly complex, despite only having two properties. Alignment controls how the child view is positioned within the rectangle given to it by its layout container. Remember, for each view, it has two layout options values, one for horizontal and one for vertical. These two values let you align the child view to any of the edges of its rectangle or to center it. Fill is different than the other values. It means a child should fill its entire rectangle. Again, each view has two of these values, so you can independently control whether the child fills a rectangle in just one direction or both. The expands property lets a view request extra space if its parent's stack layout has any available. Expands is only used by stack layout. The value is completely ignored by the other layout containers. We'll explore expands more when we talk about stack layout. The layout alignment enum has four values: start, center, end, and fill. When you choose one of these options for either the horizontal or vertical directions, two things happen. Your width request or height request setting is used to determine the view size in that direction. If the view doesn't have a size, its default size is used for that axis. The view is then aligned to the side of the layout rectangle you specify. In this case, the stack layout gives each label a layout rectangle spanning the entire width, start, center, and end position within that rectangle. Phil, however, says to ignore any width request or height request setting and instead size the view so it occupies the entire rectangle in that direction. A view can have more than one property setting that influences its size. For example, it could have a width request of 100 and a horizontal options of fill. In these cases, the two settings might conflict. Suppose a layout panel is 300 units wide. The panel cannot simultaneously make the view 100 units wide and have it fill the layout width. The fill options will take precedence in this case, and the width request is ignored. This can be confusing since fill is also the default. Let's look at that next. Horizontal options and vertical options will both default to fill, making these two declarations identical. It's important to keep in mind this when debugging a UI. It's easy to forget, and it can make it very hard to figure out why your view rendered the way it did. You may want a bit of extra space around a view. For example, suppose you have some buttons next to each other. You may want to add room around them to avoid accidental touches. This is exactly what the margin property is for. It lets you include extra space around any view. Margin is of type thickness, so you have several options on how you'd like to specify the value. The most flexible option is to give individual values for all four sides.
The order is left, top, right, and bottom.
Another option is to give two values. The first is used on the left and right sides. The second is used for the top and bottom. Finally, you can give a single value used for all four sides. There's another option to add some extra space, but this one's only available to layout panels. The padding property adds space inside a layout panel. It reduces the area available to layout children. Padding is also a thickness type, so you have the exact same options for setting it that we saw with margin.